Thank you, Robin, and welcome all here to this brown bag about tools that we make here to make our life easier at Enviso. So if you're familiar with my presentations, I usually take questions during my presentations, but here, because of technicalities, we will do that at the end, but I will make sure that we will have time for questions. Now, also another thing, if you already watched this presentation about a year ago, I also made this presentation, know that this one here is a different one. So the slides are the same. I haven't changed the slides, but the demos, and that's the main part, the demos are completely different. Yeah. So if you have seen this last year, well, you won't see it again this year. So I'm Didier Stevens. I'm a senior analyst at Enviso. And one of the things that I do at Enviso is malware analysis. And then also in my personal time, I like doing malware analysis. And I also do that for SANS at the Internet Storm Center. Now, what we are going to do today is tell you about some of the tools that I have, and then explain the design principles that are behind and where you can find my tools, where you can find me, and also how to start making your own tools, because that will be part here of one of the demos. That is a small introduction on making your own tools to solve your own needs. I have more than 100 free open source tools, and I have them all documented on my blog, and I have to document this, because otherwise I wouldn't remember all of the tools that I have. You can imagine if you have that many tools that you need some system to organize them. And one of the methods to do that is on my blog. You have several entries on my blog here. This page, for example, gives you an alphabetical list of all the tools that I have. So for example, one of the tools that we will use today here is Base64 Dump. This is a tool to extract Base64 strings from files. So that is one of the tools that is listed there. Okay, so without further ado, let's get started with the demo. So I have here my command line. And what I'm going to do is the following. Imagine that you are an analyst and that you are tasked with looking at a malicious Word document, figuring out what this malicious Word document does. Now, what I'm going to do here now first is show you what you could do if you don't have any tools. So my malicious Word document is here inside sample.zip. That's a file that was given to me. And in by the conventions for malware analysis, it is in a password protected zip file and the password is infected. So I will extract this. Now, this is already the first thing that you shouldn't do. This is something you should do in a virtual machine or in a sandbox. You shouldn't do this on your own machine. Now I'm going to extract the file here. See, I need to type a password, infected. And now I have the Word document. Now, if you don't have any tools, the only thing that you can do is open this with Word. Again, that's something that you shouldn't do in a production or test machine, only on virtual machines or sandboxes that are well protected. So I open this. And as you can see, as with a typical malicious documents that contain executable content like VBA macros, there is a warning here above. Security warning, macros have been disabled. And I can click enable content to execute it. But again, that's not something that you want to do when you do a static analysis. What I want to do here is now look if there is VBA code, malicious VBA code inside this document. So let me do this. So I can go to the VBA editor by pressing Alt F11. And now here I am in the editor. And as you can see, I can see some code here. Now this is code that I prepared this morning. It is pseudocode. It's not actual real functional code, but I made it kind of pseudocode so that it is better understandable. So I have auto open here. Auto open, that is the name of a subroutine in Word that will execute automatically once execution is enabled. Okay, so there is no user interaction required for that macro to run. And you can see here execute shellcode is executed and then message box infected is displayed. Execute shellcode, what does it do? Extract shellcode, and then you have a base64 payload, decode base64 payload with as input the base64 payload, and then you have shellcode, and then run the shellcode, and the shellcode is executed. Okay. If you look at the individual functions like extract shellcode, you see that there is no actual code. I kept it simple. There I put in simply a command to tell it what it does. So what does extract shellcode does? It extracts the code, the shellcode, from the comments property. So that is something that you would see in the VBA code, like application document, if I'm not mistaken, and then properties like comments. So, okay, so you have this open and then you understand, yes, the payload is inside the comments. So let's take a look at the comments. So I come back to Word, file, info. And as you can see here now, I have the properties, comments, and here you see this thing. This is base64. So this is our shellcode that is base64 encoded. And this is something that is typical for malicious documents. That is one of the places where they hide their payload. What do you have to do then here, since you have no other tools? Well, you select this and I copy this. Now I have the base64 code. Now I need to decode this. Again, you need a tool to do this. You could, for example, use CyberChef, a very useful tool that can do all kinds of decodings. You have it online or you can save it locally. Here, I am going to use an editor, a binary editor, the 010 editor. So I'm here in this editor. I create a new file. And now I say edit, paste from base64. So this will do the base64 decoding and then paste the decoded shellcode into the editor like this. And then I see this. Yeah, this probably doesn't make a lot of sense to you, but this is the actual shellcode. Usually my font isn't that big, but I made it bigger here in the preparation so that it would be easier to read. Now, a lot of things that are not recognizable, but then you see something like here, user agent Mozilla. So there is a string inside here. And if you go at the end, you can also see an IPv4 address, 185.205.210.179. Now, if you have shellcode, that is a downloader and it's not obfuscated, then you will often find the URLs or the IP addresses at the end of the shellcode in clear text. And that's what we have here. This is an actual malicious sample. This is an actual shellcode that I took from one of our diary entries on the SANS Internet Storm Center. So I have this file here. It is in my editor. I can now, for example, look at the strings that are inside. So let's do this. If you go here in the search function, you see here find strings. And then I click find strings. Find strings that are minimum 5 characters. Do a find. And here you see all kinds of strings it finds. But here you see the user agent string that is found. So that is one of the methods that you can do here again, if you don't have any tools. So this is how I actually had to do it when there was a revival of malicious documents. So by the end of 2014, there was a revival of malicious Office documents with VBA code. They were very popular at the end of the 90s and the beginning of the 2000s, and then they declined. And then by the end of 2014, there was a new revival. And unfortunately for us, I call this a revival, but it is still going on. End of 2014, that's a bit more than 6 years ago, but we are still dealing with malicious Office documents. Okay. So what I started to do back then, because this is not practical at all, and also quite error prone, you can easily make a mistake and infect yourself. Like, for example, if I go back here to the document, and for example, I click by mistake here, enable content, then it executes and you then see my machine would be infected because of the message box. So that's not a good way to do it. And what I started to do back then is develop a tool to help me with the analysis of Office documents. And now I'm going to show you how to use that tool. I have a command line here, and it's in folder one here, that I have my sample. So I already have my doc that I created. Let me delete that one because I just extracted this. Okay. So I already had, from the late 2008, 2009, had PDF tools, because back then PDF were, malicious PDFs were very popular. But now their popularity has declined a lot. Now it's Office documents. So I started to develop a tool to help me with the analysis. And that tool is OLEDump. It's a Python tool. You run it in the command line, and to execute it, you give it the input. Now here, I will just give it sample.zip, run it, and you can see already I have output. Now what is happening here, and that is one of the design principles of my tools, that is that most of my tools can handle samples that are stored inside a zip container. And even with a password protection, a password infected here, my tool, I developed it, it's one of its features, that it recognizes when something is inside the zip container, and then it will try the password infected. So it managed to do that. It will then extract the document, the Word document, in memory. It doesn't write anything to disk, it does all of this in memory. And then it displays you the analysis of this document. Now, I'm not going to go into the internal details of a Word document, but this is a binary document, so a doc, a .doc, and which is an OLE file. And an OLE file is actually also a kind of container that contains items of binary data. These are called streams. And that is what you see here. This is the list of streams from 1 to 11. I have 11 streams in that document. And the streams that are indicated with an M, they contain VBA macro code. So these are the first streams that you want to look at. How do you look at that streams? Well, you run the tool again. So remember, this here is number 7. This number is not actually something that is present inside the document, inside the OLE file, but it's something that my tool adds. It's an index so that you can easily select it. So yeah, let me already type the command here. Sorry, OLEDump, select 7. So option S, 7, this will select stream 7. And then again, I give it the sample. And then it will select that sample and do an hexadecimal ASCII dump of that sample for you. Yeah. Now that is not very useful when it comes to VBA macros, because they are compressed inside that stream. So we want to decompress them. And that's what you do with option V, VBA decompression, because it's a compression specific for VBA for Office. When you do that, you see exactly the same code as we saw when we opened the Word document. So this is the advantage here when you have to do a manual analysis like this, is that you can do this with a tool that is not relying on Office. You don't need Office or anything. You just need Python. And then you can use this tool and you can see all the code. Again, then we do our analysis here and we understand that it is in the comments property. So the next thing we can do is go to look at the metadata. And with option M, uppercase M, you can look at the metadata. And here you have the metadata. And you can see the Base64 string. Not only the metadata, but also my user account that I used here to create this test user. Also the date that I created and saved this. So you can see it was, I prepared this example here this morning. And for the ones that know me, I'm not an early riser. So I didn't make this at 7:24. I'm not Michelle or something like that. I'm still asleep at 7:24. You see this because this is in UTC. The data that is displayed here by my tool is in UTC. In Belgium here, we are in summertime, so we are two hours ahead of UTC. So this was done at 9:24 this morning. Okay, so coming back here, now we have our Base64. So exactly the same Base64 that we had here in 010 editor. Okay. Now I'm going to analyze this Base64 string. And I'm not going to copy paste this. Again, I'm going to use one of my tools. And what I'm going to do is use a very powerful feature of operating systems. It started with Unix, sorry, not Linux. It started with Unix, as far as I know. And that is that you can pipe the output of one command into the input of another command. And that's what I'm going to do here. And you do that with the pipe character. And so that line, that vertical line, that is the pipe character. And it means the output of OliDump, pipe that into another tool. Now I have the metadata here that I want. And now I'm going to pipe this into one of my other tools, BaseDump64. BaseDump64 here, well, it's actually Base64Dump, sorry. It's a tool that can do Base64 decoding and also many other decodings, hexadecimal and other kinds of decodings. It's not only Base64Dump. But it does not only do the decoding, it will also search for such strings into its input. So it will search for anything that is syntactically a valid Base64Dump with the input that you presented. And that's what we have here. So you can see there is a lot of output now. So each string that it recognizes is listed as an entry, 1, 2, 3, and so on. You see, for example, there is a code page. That's one of the words that's inside there. Syntactically, code page is a valid Base64 string. But that's not a Base64 string that we are interested in. Typically, our Base64 strings are longer than just 8 characters. And that is an option, and that illustrates one of the features of my tools. That is, I have many options to change its behavior. With option N, you can say a minimum length that you want it to process. So we want here at least 10 bytes. And then when you run the tool, you can see that you only have one input. One output. It found one string, and that is our Base64 string. Here you have the start of the value, here the start of the decoding, and here the MD5 hash. So if, for example, you could take this MD5 hash now directly and look it up in VirusTool to see if it is present there, and then continue your analysis there. Now, if you don't like MD5, if you say, no, I want something stronger, then it's something you can also configure in my tools. So I have here that Base64. Now I can again do the same principle, select one, and then again the two tools will run. So OliDump will do the analysis again, extract the the metadata that contains the Base64, and then with Base64Dump we see the Base64. So I select that Base64 string, the decode Base64 string, and I'm going to do an ASCII hex dump like this. And now you can see what we actually saw here in 010 editor. That is the code in its hexadecimal ASCII representation. And here you see, for example, again, the string. So the IPv4 address. Now, when I have this, I can also do a binary dump. So not hexadecimal ASCII dump, but pure binary, like this. And you can see here user agent Mozilla string, here the thing. What can you do with the binary input? Well, you can write it to disk. So for example, shellcode.vir, that's one of the things you can do. Or you can again pipe it into another command. So let me first here clear the screen like that. And now, for example, I would like to extract strings, do a string extraction. So I'm going to use the strings command from sysinternals. And you will see, unfortunately, this will not work. You get this message. What is actually happening here is that the strings command from Mark Rustinovich from sysinternals, that string command, it does not accept input from standard in. It always expects a file not standard in, so that's unfortunate. But I found this to be so useful that I started to code my own strings in Python. So with strings.py, I can do this, and then I have this output. Okay. I could also pipe this into another tool, for example, a disassembler, the NetWhite disassembler. Tell it that it's 32 bit the code. And then sell it that the input is standard in with the dash. And then here you see the decoded basics, sorry, the disassembled shellcode. Now, reading shellcode, that's not easy. You need skills to do that. Now, this particular shellcode here that I took again from the SANS Internet Storm Center diary entry. This one is actually coming from CobbleStrike. And the CobbleStrike shellcode is very similar to the MeterPreter shellcode. And I also developed tools to help you with that. So I'm just going to run it, not giving any more details, but if you pipe it into that tool here, that's specific for CobbleStrike, you have to dump, but then here, as you can see, it will give you information like the IP address. It will extract the IP address, also the path, and here the user agent string. That's what I wanted to illustrate here with this demo. That is that I make tools, first of all, that I don't have to use the actual applications that are vulnerable, that I am not relying on existing tools, that I can do this on different operating systems. I'm doing this here on Windows, but this works on any operating system that supports Python. And then I also do this in the Unix, Linux philosophy, that you have small tools with options that you string together. So let's come back to the slides. So how does it all started with me? Well, in the 80s, I was using an Apple II computer. And back then there wasn't that much software if you wanted to hack that computer. And by hacking, I don't mean breaking into it, because we are talking about the 80s, personal computers of the 80s. There was no security at all because there was no need for security back then. There was no internet. It's only later in the 80s that I had a modem connected to BBS. So, I mean, there was no security because security was not an issue. By hacking, I mean making my own stuff in that computer. So I had to develop my own tools. So that's the origin, that I started to make my own tools. And then later also in the 80s, I started to use Unix. I got familiarized with Unix and I was really impressed really by that system of having command, small command line tools that you string together. And that's what I tried to replicate here. Later also, I started to use the Windows sysinternal tools at the early 2000s. That was also a source of inspiration to me. Now, why do I like to do this? Well, first of all, the very main reason is to solve my problems. So back then in 2014 and later on, I was working at a place where I had to analyze malicious documents because they were coming in through email. So I had to make my own tools so that I could do the analysis without relying on anything else. A very useful thing about making your own tools is that you have to research and learn. For example, when I started with PDFs back in 2008, I didn't know anything about the PDF language, the underlying internal structure. I had to figure that all that out. And by trying to make a program that understands all that, you have to understand it really well so that you can code it. So that's also an advantage of making your own tools. Another thing is that making your own tools also gives you some kind of documentation of what you are doing. If I come back to my command here, so this command here, if I copy paste this into a document, for example, with Notepad, no, not that Notepad, here and paste this and then save this as a text file, I have already documented the exact steps I took for the analysis. I could, for example, add the hash here of that file and have a bit more documentation. And so that part is already easier to do, to document, compared to the first manual method that I presented that you are using the tools itself. And then you have to really take screenshots, for example, and write down what you do. And then also another thing is actually for me, writing code is relaxing. So when I'm tired or stressed, writing code for me, it's just an easy way to escape everything, to relax. I can't assure that it will work for you. It's an individual taste, but yeah, with me, that's the case. So the design principles behind my tools, I want them to be generic, solve more than one problem, and that's through options. I make them flexible by providing options. I make them portable. I try to make them without the least amount of installation required, Python, and then sometimes one library, but I try to keep it at that. Also that they work on different operating systems, that they are not tied to one specific operating system. Modular, that I can combine tools and reuse tools. Okay, let's do a second demo. Okay. What I have here now, and let me also take the Explorer view. So what I have here now is something that I started to see at the Internet Storm Center a couple of years ago. And from time to time, it reappears. And what is it? It's malware that is emailed to a victim, but not directly, but it is stored inside a container. That container is an ISO file. So a CD file, a DVD file, so the binary file that represents the content of a disk, a DVD, that is an ISO file. That is something that wasn't feasible to do by the malware routers, by the attackers, before the arrival of Windows 10, because until Windows 7, you had no internal tools in Windows to mount ISO files. But since Windows 7, you have that. So I have that ISO file. Now, to analyze this, back then, 2017, I didn't have any tools. So what I did back then was use the command line version of 7-zip. I'm going to use here the GUI version of 7-zip, but if you open this file, you can see here two files inside that ISO file, beacon.dll.vir and invoice.doc.lnk. So this is an ISO file that contains something malicious. So you want to look inside and do the analysis. So here I would, for example, extract this. Now, what I'm going to illustrate here is how you can make, with a couple of lines of code, how you can make your own tool to do this. And for that, I'm going to start with process binary files. Now, since a couple of years, I have open sourced two templates, Python templates, so that's actual Python code, that I use to make my other tools. So often if I start a new tool, I will use one of these two templates. This is the template for binary files, and you also have a template for text files. Now this template for binary files in itself, it already does something. If you give it a file like this, it will read that file and do an hex ASCII dump of the first 256 bytes of that file. So that is already in that code. I can show you that. Here with the editor. Okay. So, okay. So there's a lot of code in here, but the code that you actually have to change if you want to use my template to start your own template is this. So this is just the code that does what we saw there, reading the data, well, processing the data and then doing a dump. You can see here the line that does the hex ASCII dump. What I'm going to do now is replace that code to do something with ISO files, that we can read ISO files. And for that, I have ISO dump, but I will show that later. I have here a very first version of that tool ISO dump. Where ISO, and as you can see, when you run it, it just gives you the name of the two files that are inside. So let's take a look at that sample. So this is the code. You can see it's actually just three lines. So what I'm using is PutLab. PutLab is an open source tool, an Python module that you can install with PIP. And PutLab will allow you to read different kinds of container files, like for example, ISO files. And you do that through the ISO accessor. So with that module imported, I can already start analyzing ISO files. And what I needed to give it is the file, the input that I gave it. And in my template, that is data. So if you are here, data, that is the file that was read. And it will also works with standard input, all kinds of features, and also the zip file with password protected. You have all that features here in the template. Now you have to do some conversion for PutLab. I'm not going to go into details here, but that is some conversions to necessary for PutLab, that it is actually a file object. And then once I have that file object, I can say I'm going to the root directory, so slash the root directory isopart, and there I want an iteration of that directory, so the content. And that is here a list of output files, and then I just iterate over those output files, and I take the property part and I print that out. I don't use print, you can use oOutput.line. And then you also have options for your output that you can redirect your output through command line and other things. So you see here just three lines to achieve this result. The next step is that we want a bit more information. So not only do we want the name, but we also want the size and the index. So let me show you the lines, the code for that. Here is that code. So that first line, it's just the same. The second line has changed a bit. Now we are enumerating the O files. And by using enumerate, then you not only you have each object, but you also have an index from 0 to the number of objects minus 1. And then I will here do an output line to print the index, the size of the file, and you can have that through stat size. And that is information that you find in the documentation of PathLab. If you go to PathLab, you can find documentation and read the docs. And there you can see which properties you need to access to have the size and here the part. And this is my index. Now remember, I start from zero, but here I like to display one. So I'm going to increment this with one, index plus one. And that's all there is to it, this, to achieve this result, to have already more information, to see the size, for example, not only the name. Next, of course, we want to extract what is inside there. We want to look at those files. So that is step three. If you run example three, you have again the same output. But now, I also, if you go to the help, I also included a select option. What I can do now is say, sorry, select, I'm going to select two. That's a small file. And then you immediately have an hexadecimal ASCII dump of that file that was selected. So let's take a look at the code and how to achieve that. Yeah, so here I added one line for the select option. So I added that option. And then now here in my code, as you can see, again, it is quite similar. So here that line hasn't changed to get the content of the file, of the ISO file. And here now I test, did I select anything? If I didn't select anything, so if select is an empty string, then I do just what I do before, list the content. If select, however, is different, then what I'm going to do is convert that select value that I gave to an integer, subtract one from it, because objects in Python are indexed starting from zero. And then here in my files, my object files that I have to convert to a list here, I'm just going to index this. And I'm going to say, I want that all element in the file, in the list here of items, I want that element. So in my example, it is 2 minus 1, so that's 1. So integer here is 1, and then I select the second file in that list. And when I have that second file, here again, if you read the docs, you just have to do read bytes and then you have the content of that file. I store that in variable content and then I just do an ASCII dump like I did in the previous example. So, and this is then what the tool allows you to do. Look at the inside of the list of files or have an ASCII dump. So with just a few lines here. By using this template. And I also have a more complete version of IsoDump that I will release now. So you give it the malware, it gives you this output. You see it also displays the name now, and so the code is a bit different. This one is also recursive, so if there are directories and nested directories, it will also read that, that content. And then you can do a select again of number two. And then you have an ASCII dump, but you can also change this and do, for example, a binary dump like this. If I do a binary dump of that LNK file, here, and I look at the strings inside, I can see here run dll32.exe, beacon dll.vir. This is intentional so that it wouldn't execute. I added this. So you can understand that this ISO file contains a link file. And when the user clicks on this, then this link file will actually start to run DLL32 to execute the DLL. So it will load the DLL. So let's take a look at this DLL. So the DLL is the first file, so select one. I do a binary dump, and I'm going to look at the strings. Strings analysis is a quick win. Often, yeah, the strings will be obfuscated and you will not find any useful information, but it's also a quick win. You can always try it. And here you get the output, a lot of output. And then, yeah, you have to browse through that output. So that's not so convenient. And one of the features that I have added to strings, because now I have my own strings, strings.py, is to sort the output by string length so that I have the longest strings at the end, because often the longest strings are the ones that you are interested in when you do malware analysis. Not always, of course, always exceptions, but that's a useful trick. And let's do this. So now it is sorting the output by string length. And now you see this, you see already something readable. Now, a tip here, if you see a lot of lowercase letters I, like here, here that end, there is a very long sequence of letter I, lowercase letter I. If you see something like this, you might be dealing with a COBOL strike beacon, because the configuration of a COBOL strike beacon, so the behavior of a COBOL strike beacon is encoded in a configuration, and that configuration is stored inside. That configuration is binary representation, and it is also XOR encoded, but with a simple key, either a lowercase e or a dot. And so if you have a lot of values I, then you might have a COBOL strike configuration with a lot of zero null bytes that have been XORed with I, and so you end up with that I, long strings of I. And of course, the name beacon, that tells it too. So let's pipe this into my tool, 1768.py. This is my tool that I developed to analyze COBOL strike beacons. The name 1762 is a small joke. 1768 degrees Kelvin is the melting point of the metal cobalt. And that's why I called my tool like this. So let's try this out. And then indeed you get output like this. So you see here all kinds of information like the C2, this is here an IP address, and then the path it will use for GET requests. This is the path it will use for POST URIs. This is the user agent string that that beacon will use. It is an HTTP beacon. It will connect to port 4321. So with that tool, you can quickly analyze beacons if you are indeed dealing with beacons. And that is a tool that I also started. I don't think that I had it, well, at least it wasn't public back when I did my first brown bag here on this topic. But now it is public, this tool. And so it is based on my process binary file template. I started with that template to make this tool here. Of course, to do all the decoding, because there is also different obfuscations, that tool is quite more complex than the ISO dump that that we saw here. So, where can you find the tools? Information, well, first of all, on our blog, on Enviso. We have a lot of very good writers there on our Enviso blog post. I invite you to take a look. I also write a blog post there from time to time. On the SANS Internet Storm Center, there I'm a handler at the SANS Internet Storm Center. There you can find my tools on my blog and then also on my YouTube, because I also make recordings of my videos. The software you can find on my blog, on my GitHub, also on the Enviso GitHub, and also on other tools, because I didn't mention this yet, but I think it's in the description. My tools, some of my tools are also used in SANS trainings. And that is why, for example, you will find it in Remnux distro by Lenny Seltzer to do a reverse engineering of malware, and also in Kali, you can find my tools. And before I will start taking questions, I also would like to make a call here, do an invitation to start making your own tools. Even if it's difficult to get started, take a look at my templates and start with that. As you saw here, it doesn't take many lines to get started to do an ISO dump tool. Of course, you need to understand what you are doing. You need to find that library to parse ISO files. You have to read the documentations, try to understand it, do trial and error. But the great thing about doing this and trying to make code to do that is that you will far better understand the inner workings, the internal format of ISO files through that library that you are using. Okay, so let's see for the questions now.
Yes, thanks a lot, Didier. We did have a couple of questions in. Let me share them as well.
Yes.
So people can follow along in the presentation. Okay. All right, so I can handle the first question. Actually, will the session be recorded? Yes, the session is recorded, and you can watch the recording simply by going to the URL you originally used to join.
So is the file so simple, available anywhere so we can follow along? So yeah, that's a bit late, but it's not available now, but we will make it available and that you can use it.
Yeah, and then you can just follow along with the recording.
Yeah. And also, it is based on the SANS Internet SOM Center sample, so you can also find them the description on the Internet SOM Center. But what I wanted to say also is that what we try to do now also at the Internet SOM Center, when we talk about malware or samples, if we are at the liberty of sharing that sample, we will upload to Malware Bazaar. And then you can find it on Malware Bazaar, and you can download it from there. I don't think you'd even need an account on Malware Bazaar. You can just straight download it if you have the hash or the link. No, I usually use pile tools. I have some compile tools, but as far as I know, I didn't publish them. And it's actually a compiled version of OLEDump, Base64Dump, and a couple of other tools so that I could use them on a Windows machine where Python couldn't even be installed. We had to do that on Python. And then if you go to our Enviso blog, you will also see that we made a Python decompiler written in Python, so Pytecode. Well, actually not a decompiler itself, but an interface to a library that does the decompilation. And the thing about that library is that it changed regularly. And by changing, I mean breaking changes. So you do an update with pip and yeah, it no longer works. You get an error. And then we decided to actually compile that tool into an exe, and if I'm not mistaken, we also compiled it into Linux so that compilation would contain the complete modules, the complete libraries that are dependent on it, so that it would always work even if there was an update. If there is an update, of course you wouldn't have the update, but you would have the old version that still works. Okay.
All right. Thanks.
When you encounter obfuscated strings, do you attempt to reconstruct them or do you try to tackle the file in a different way, skipping strings analysis? It depends. One of the tools that I have will do a small XOR brute force and small XOR dictionary attack. It is called XOR search. Sometimes I will use that. But and then also, yeah, the thing is, I regularly do malware analysis. I do it often, and I can also just recognize some of the obfuscation schemes by seeing them. For example, a very simple obfuscation scheme that I can see easily through is that you have your string, for example, a URL, and inside that string, you will add a lot of characters that have no meaning whatsoever into a URL. So let's say, for example, what can I say? An asterisk. Yeah? Let's say that we use an asterisk. So at random places, you put one or more asterisks into that URL to do the obfuscation. That's one of the techniques that they do. Well, I can sometimes just recognize that and see that. And when I see that, then I will just use, for example, TR, the translate tool from Linux, TR, to just filter out the asterisks. And then I will see the clear text URLs. So it depends. I will not spend a lot of time on string analysis if it doesn't lead to anything. Okay. Do you have tools for binary firmware analysis? No. I did have tools for iOS. And by that, I mean iOS with an uppercase, so the Cisco iOS. It is called the Network Analysis Forensic Toolkit. But I no longer maintain it because I don't have any new hardware, Cisco hardware. That's just it. So that tool can do some analysis of Cisco firmware and also memory dumps. But you can, for firmware analysis, you can, for example, also use my Base64 dump tool to look up all kinds of encodings. So there are many encodings in that tool, not only Base64. So sometimes that can also help with firmware analysis. But I don't have.
Didier.
Sorry.
Yeah, your last sentence was broken up a bit for me. So I mean, yeah.
Okay, sorry. So no, I don't have specific tools for binary firmware analysis except for iOS, but that's no longer maintained. So Cisco iOS, but you can use some of my tools, Base64, to do some simple things like looking for encodings like Base64 hexadecimal, these kind of things. Okay.
All right. Thanks a lot. That concludes all of our questions. So I want to thank you for presenting, Didier. I want to thank everyone for joining as well. I've put the link to your scripts on the screen as well. If you have any more questions about this talk or in general, you can always reach out to us on our Twitter and on our LinkedIn as well. We organize these talks on a wide variety of cybersecurity topics almost every Thursday at noon. Next week, we'll be hosting Michel Koenen, where he will be talking about purple teaming. And these talks are organized by Envisio. We are a cybersecurity company based in Europe. We offer a wide range of cybersecurity services. So if you're interested in that, you can find them all on our website, envisio.eu. And we're also hiring. So if that's something that you're interested in, you can find that as well on our website. So, once again, thank you, everyone, and take care. Oh, before we leave, I saw here some last comments coming in, but it was a thank you message, so not another question. Okay, all right, so we can end the stream here. Thanks, everyone. Thank you, Didier.
Okay, see you.